Okay, so participants, these are the instructions. Your presentation time is 6 minutes maximum, and you have to start with your research gap if you have found out any. All right, usually a research will have a research gap. Only that research gap we will try to address, and that research gap will be your hypothesis. Okay, so research gap, hypothesis. Then you have to talk about the objective of the study, the argument, maybe in say 5 to 6 sentences, and then finally the findings. So I repeat, objective, then you have the research gap, hypothesis, then comes the findings, and if you wish, you can put your arguments in 5 to 8 sentences. So this will be the model, and you are given just 6 minutes. Vishnu Priya can start. Vishnu Priya is there.
Okay, Vairamani Periyasamy.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sir, you can start now.
Yeah, am I audible, ma'am?
Ah, yes, sir, it's audible.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Very good afternoon to all. I'm Vairamani from Commerce College of Engineering Technology. I'm happy to meet you all in this pleasant afternoon. And the paper that I have entitled is The Creation of Wealth and Success in Devrat Patnaik's The Success Sutra. Actually, the purpose of this paper is to get success in life, especially in this critical scenario. Every one of us in this world would like to earn money, and in many books it stated that we have to run after money. So in this Success Sutra, the author describes that, why don't we make money? That is, he's a mythologist who says about the life with the help of mythological fact, especially from Hindu mythology as well as from Buddhist. And he says about the Success Sutra, actually the Sutra means a string which connects the dots, and it creates a whole pattern. Likewise, it connects people from one place to another, one country to another, one mind to another. So when we learn how to control the mind, we come to know the work is half done. Even though we are varied from culture to culture or language to language, whereas there are some concepts which are common to all the people, especially for human beings, it is common to all. Here the author gives 4 elements which are very, very essential for a person to run an organization or to get success in life, especially in education sector for the students, as well as in any places. So these 4 elements which are essential, what are they? They are decision, second one, violence, third one, selection, and last, charming. It can be called turning also. So, first one, decision. To decide to do something, it is must for everyone to choose the right term properly. So here the author takes some examples from the Hindu mythology, especially from the Ramayana, where Vishwamitra asked Dasaratha to send his son to kill Taraga, the demon. So it was the first decision made by Vishwamitra in order to bring out the talent of a person. So likewise, if we start an organization, we need to decide first, and later we'll show violence. Violence in the sense is not to harm anyone. Without harming, things should be done. And after violence, get into the process, we go for selection. In order to sell a product, a person must know how to seduce other people, how to attract people towards him. So selection is must for every one of us, and at last it is turning. Turning in the sense, in an organization, a person must know how to earn wealth. So like the Devas and the Asuras, they churn the ocean of milk in order to get Amrita. The same way, a head of an organization should know how to go and how to pull so that he or she could earn the organization. That's the main source which would I like to discuss in this paper. So decision, violence, selection, and turning. These are the four things which are stated in this paper. Thanks for the opportunity given. Thank you.
Sir, it was a wonderful presentation. Out of the box, good. And your name, please?
Yes, sir. Vairamani, sir. Vairamani from Madurai. Vairamani.
Vairamani, okay.
Vairamani. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Ma'am, the next participant.
Dr. Vithya. Dr. Vithya. Okay.
Ma'am, previous, previous participant or name, Vairamana.
P. Vairamani Periyasami.
Okay, right.
Okay, sir. Next, Dr. S. Vidya. I think she is not present here. And next one is Professor M. Vinod Kude.
Yes. Am I audible, sir?
Sir, you are audible, but you can be a bit louder.
Okay, sir.
Now fine. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. Okay, sir. I'm Mr. Vinod Kukre, sir.
Yeah.
And my topic is Eco-Critical Outlook of Subalterns in Nectarinous Sea of Kamala Markandeya and in the Hungry Tide of Amitav Ghosh. So in this paper, I especially focus on the outlook, thoughts, and approach of the subalterns towards ecology and environment that Kamala Markandeya and Amitav Ghosh present in their novels, that Nectarinous Sea and the Hungry Tide. And the both writers are great environmentalists who deep sense of ecological perspective presented the subalterns lives. So in these novels, in the special Nectarinous Sea, Rukmani, Nathan, their children and some other inhabitants figure as subalterns, and in the Hungry Tide, Fokir, Moina and others, some of the inhabitants also figure as subalterns. And I especially focus here on Rukmani, Nathan and also Fokir in the Hungry Tide. So my objective actually is here just to show subalterns as the real preserver and the protector of nature, and to show them as they maintain the relationship with the nature as well as with the man. So my findings here are like that the subalterns are more attached to the nature, and though living in the lap of nature, they conserve, preserve and protect the nature directly or indirectly. As Rukmani, Nathan in Nectarinous Sea love nature, farming. Rukmini is shown to be loving the birds, animals, and feeling pity for the bullocks, and she even loves the tree plants. In the Hungry Tide, Fokir, the subaltern, knows in detail the area of Sundarbans and attach more to the nature. So it is found that in a depressed and miserable condition, the subaltern never lose their attachment and love to the nature. In the life of Rukmani and Nathan, there are a number of problems which are caused by the nature also, because nature is shown as preserver and the destroyer also. As the nature's fury in the form of the storm destroyed the crops, earning sources, and they had to, Rukmani and Nathan had to lose their hired land. But it is found that they never feel any indignant towards the nature, rather they extend their love. They want to live in the lap of the nature, and when they decide to live the village and go into the city to work there, that city, but they return there because they only remember their farming. So their love we have found here. And even in the Hungry Tide, Fokir in a great storm is seen to be appreciating the beauty of the birds, tigers. Actually, Sundarbans is a very dangerous place to live, but the subalterns live there. They survive there, even that is a dangerous condition, and even they love the animals, they love that mangroves, they love that beauty. And subalterns are also shown against industrialization. We find this example as Rukmani never liked the establishment of tannery in the village. She was totally against it. And also that tannery destroyed their life, even because of doing work. Their children, two children also just sacrificed their lives, or they died there. Fakir in the Hungry Tide, the local person, he never likes the people of just city area to trespass the Sundarbans. Actually, the government had decided just that to frame the border there so that the subalterns may not enter the reserve areas, Morin Jhampi. But never, they are trying, the government is trying, but the inhabitants, the subalterns, they are not leaving that place. Rather, they are living in such a dangerous area because they are lover of the nature. Next, subalterns are honest and devoted to the nature, and also they maintain the relationship with the men. As Rukmani knows, when she comes to know that her husband's relationship is with Kunti, but she does not behave with her in a very detesting manner. And even we have found in the Hungry Tide, Fakir also sacrifices his life to save the life of Pia Leroy, who is Calcutta-born American lady. So we find here they are really a very honest and devoted nature. So to conclude, I say that both the novels show that the subalterns are the real heroes who have close kinship with the nature, and they keep alive the agrarian and forest culture. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Good insights. Next participant.
Thank you, sir.
Ma'am, next participant.
Okay, next, Wazim Ahmed Bani.
Yes, ma'am, I'm present.
Okay. You can start now.
Good afternoon, one and all. I'm Wazim, research scholar, and the title of my research paper is Transformation from Coolies to Entrepreneurs, a study of Rubain Lakshman Singh's A Dip at the Sangam. This paper is about the Indian indentured laborers' migration to British Guyana. The Indian indenture system was a system of indenture servitude by which more than 1 million Indians were transported to labor in European colonies as a substitute for slave labor following the abolition of the trade in 19th century. This labor migration resulted in the development of a large Indian diaspora in the Caribbean, South Africa, Reunion, Mauritius, Sri Lanka, Malaysia, Myanmar, and Fiji. British Guyana was the first Caribbean region which received indentured labor from India in 1838. Importing labor became viable for plantation owners because newly emancipated slaves refused to work for low wages. The Indian indentured laborers were promised free return passage after the completion of their contract. The Indian indentured laborers were derogatorily called as coolies by their masters. They were mostly illiterate, hence unable to understand or record their experience in the literal form. We have only two memoirs written by the coolie workers, an autobiography of an indentured laborer by Munshi Rahman Khan, and Fiji Dweep Mein Mere Akis Varsh, My 21 Years in Fiji by Totaram Sandhya. The descendants of Indian indentured laborers recorded the history and culture of their forefathers, both in theory and practice. Historians like Brijvi Lal and David Dabedin worked very hard to record the oral testimonies of their ancestors. Poets, dramatists, and novelists have preserved their ancestors' past and depicted the struggles and hardships of their destitute forefathers. Rubain Lakshman Singh is also the descendant of the Indian indentured laborer from India. In his novel, A Dip at the Sangam, he revisits the past and recreates the whole situation. Against the backdrop of the plantation life, the author lures the reader into a world of intrigue, adventure, and romance. It's a story of greed, injustice, and abuse of power. It debunks the colonial discourse which regarded Indians as the poverty-stricken and jobless people. Instead, it unveils the truth about the British imperial rulers who transformed the whole agricultural and industrial system, leading peasants into much distress. They also ruined the indigenous handicraft and handloom industries. The handloom weavers were harassed to leave their family business and were made physically handicapped to quit their business. To fulfill the required quota of the cheap laborers, people were sometimes deceived by false promises of luxury or kidnapped by using force. Because of this, indentureship was also called as the new system of slavery. In the present novel, Lakshman Singh focuses on the development of laborers from coolies to prosperous entrepreneurs. They successfully made a new identity in the alien land. They suffered all oddities with great fervor, passion, discipline, proper strategy, changed their position from the debased condition to business entrepreneurs.
Sir, last 2 minutes, your findings.
Sir, I am just concluding. There was one sentence. To conclude, yeah. I would say that Raja, the protagonist, makes good as a free man in the new colony. His socio-economic success is the microcosm of the achievements of the whole indentured laborers. Thanks, sir.
Sir, what is your suggestion for their problem?
Sir, it is a historical topic, and the author has very minutely depicted the whole situation and provides a counter argument to the imperial depiction which they have depicted, that they were landless, they were poor, they were poverty stricken. And in this novel, he suggested that they were not basically poor. It was the British who took their jobs and lands, and because of taxation and other things, ruined their business and made them very miserable, made their situation very miserable, and hence they have no opportunity in their own homeland, so they have to leave and work in the other Caribbean or other nations as laborers, indentured laborers.
Very good, very good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Next, Yamuna.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. I am an assistant professor in Ani Teresa Arts and Science College, and I'm a PhD scholar in Rajeshwari Vedachalam Government Arts College, Sengalpattu, in Tamil Nadu. My topic is Shiro concept in feminism. Subaltern is all about suppression and exploitation. I have thought about the solution, the mindset essential to fight without straining the relationships. It is in this context the Shiro concept emerged. I would like to share my PPT. Can I, sir?
Yes, yes, please.
The origin of the word is traced back to mid 19th century. Shiro is a blend of she and hero. She plus hero is Shiro. Shiro means a woman admired or idealized for her courage, outstanding achievements, or noble qualities. In short, a Shiro is a female savior. The paper has projected the seven mothers from Indian mythology and epic as represented in Dr. K.R. Srinivasa Iyengar's Sati Saptakam, Saga of Seven Mothers as Shiros. The seven mothers are Devahuti, Suganya, Devayani, Damayanti, Renuka, Draupati, and Kanagi.
Ma'am, your hypothesis, your argument and findings.
Ah, yes, sir.
Be brief.
Okay, sir. My hypothesis are the Shiro concept. Many researchers have done Sudha Murthy in various angles, but no one has said in this context of finding out the Shiro. The significance of the myth, which has been elaborately stated in the introduction to emphasize the study of myth and the awakening of the archetypes who are within us. So it's a kind of prayer which in turn will enable us to manifest the Shiro in us. So the myths are relevant in the sense that it is a record of past experiences, ancient or modern. The crisis in human life is the same. So myths preach that one cannot escape problems. So the approach and attitude frame the attitude of one's personality. So the mythical women characters had a right attitude as they had awakened the Adi Shakti, the archetypal strength in them. So the seven mothers had a rich background in the childhood. They belong to a royal family. After marriage, life demands in simplicity, nobility, humility, selflessness, unconditional love, resilience, adaptation, fighting spirit, self-reliance, perseverance, humanness, and stooping to conquer mindset, all Shiro qualities. So the mothers and Bhamati and all mythical women exhibit them. And I conclude by saying that reading about them and ruminating upon them is the invocation to become a Shiro. I conclude quoting Jim Henry, who said, "The day when the..."
You are not audible.
Overrules the love of power in a...
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yes, yes, you are audible now. Come again with the sum up the climax.
The conclusion, sir?
Yeah. Conclusion.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, ma'am, you are.
Yes, sir. Reading about them and ruminating upon them is the invocation to become a Shiro, sir. I conclude quoting Jim Hendrix's words, "The power of love will overrule the love of power in us."
And it is good. And what is your suggestion based on this paper? What do you want to suggest us?
Yes. Sir, I think by telling about the mythological tales which get embedded in the minds of people, there will be psychological, sociological, emotional and spiritual impact which is immeasurable, sir. So when it acts as an elixir, we can unravel the mystery of life, death and significance of living. Through that we can find out the real identity, who we are, sir.
Yeah, very good. And please do get into the roots. When you are suggesting, you are from Tamil Nadu, right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
See, there is a phenomenon. There is a research which says if you have time, you can go through this YouTube videos of Munaivar Pandian, who has done extensive research on the way Tamils lived. And there is a belief. There is a group which claims that most of knowledge has been carried from the Tamil folk. So try to get into the roots of it. Go back to literature which existed, say, 3,000, 4,000 years back, which could give you a better understanding of things.
Okay, sir. Sure.
Okay. Good. Excellent. Next.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, next, Professor Yoga Priya.
So, yes, I'm here, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am, we can start.
So, good evening, everyone gathered here. So, first, I want to thank you, everyone, for giving me this great opportunity. So, I'm our Yoga Priya from Kadalu. So, I'm pursuing my PhD from Thrulur University. So, and my paper is about impression of hybridity in Amitabh Ghosh's Shadow Lines. So the hybridity in post-colonial theory means the mixed identities of people from different ethnic communities and avoidable role. So am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay, thank you. So the impact of hybridization plays an unavoidable role in decolonized countries. So the post-colonial writers inclined to write about hybrid identities and swinging between two cultures. So this paper is to examine the post-cultural discourse of hybridity and hybridization of the post-colonial people. So Amitabh Ghosh, a Sahitya Academy winning novel, The Shadow Lines, has scrutinized the influence of colonization and hybridity. So the novel primarily focuses on two families, that is Dada Chowdhury's family and from Bengal, and Mrs. Prince's family from London. So the novel narrates the story from three generations spread over Calcutta, London and Dhaka. So characters from different regions, culture and nationalities have been woven together in a tangible world. So the narrator's family is settled in Calcutta, and where the grandmother is a headmistress of school. Family of Maya Devi, on the other hand, these two families are friends with an English family, the Trezevens. So the friendship began when Lionel Trezevens and Dada Chowdhury met in a spiritual event. So they started their friendship at that point, and they become a friend. So here the writer says that they developed their friendship thereafter, and this friendship was strengthened by their successors. So their memories connected even though they are from different nations. So here Amitabh Ghosh plays a question. So in this novel Shadow Lines, there is a shadowed line because here Amitabh Ghosh raises a question that culture can be contained within a boundaries made by few political actions. So Ghosh believes that these shadow lines, the boundaries, the borders should be crossed. If not, if it is not possible by physically, it can be attained through imagination, through our imagination. So I would conclude that hybridization is a blending of elements from different cultures. So I feel that without cultural hybridization, the world we live is would be far or less interesting and interwoven than it now. So this is my paper. Thank you for giving me this great opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Malavika.
Hi. The last one, Yoga Priya, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you did well. Thank you.
Next, Malavika.
Can I start?
Okay, you can start. Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank you for giving me an opportunity to present my paper and for presenting it in front of you. I'm Malavika from Kerala, currently pursuing my post-graduation in English Literature from Devamata College, Koravalingad. So the title of my research paper is Analyzing Black Diaspora and Results of Colonialism in Amma Atha Aidu's Our Sister Killjoy, or Reflections from a Black-Eyed Squint. The main aim of this paper is to understand the feelings of Black diaspora and effects of colonialism in them. So basically, this novel is divided into four sections, and it's also written in a prose verse form of narrative. Here, the protagonist Sissy is a Canadian author who is granted with a scholarship to travel to Europe. And this was considered as a big deal in those times, as for Canadians, they believed that going to Europe is something like having a rehearsal to go to heaven. But our protagonists want to break the idealistic notions about the West by the Africans. Then in the first section of the novel, we can see a man named Sammy who was just invited to the dinner with our protagonist Sissy. Actually, Sammy was invited to the dinner just to praise the wonders of Europe. So he's a person who always find delight in European nations, and thus consciously or unconsciously, he always degrades his homeland. So from this example itself, it is clear that what actually colonialism has done to Black people, and how their thoughts and traditions are injected into the minds of the colonized one. This section also gives us a realization that color must always be the basis in which Europeans differentiate people, and also it is the power which decides who to live and who to die. Then, in the second section, we can see a young German woman named Marija Sommer. She's the only person in this novel who tried to see beyond the blackness of Sissy and befriends her. But later we can understand that this Marija Sommer is horribly uneducated about the matters around the globe, that is about the race and about the places in Africa. Here we can also understand that these Africans who emigrated in Europe are later seen as someone who these Africans who have emigrated to the Europe for educational purpose or leading a good life in Europe are later seen as sellouts and they completely forgot about their cultures and their land. So the third section portrays Sissy's meeting with several black people in England. And Sissy is actually a girl who doesn't really like to be in her colonial home. But she kept on consoling herself for the while that it is the only way to get people at home to know where she had been for a small period of time in her life. So thus we can say that Sissy is really a killjoy for the African diasporas in England. Here we can also understand that these black people are running away from problems only to find more of the same type. And also another important thing is that these people never tell the truth to their home. And when they went back, they acted as Binto and spoke about the wonders of being overseas. And they also pretend to degrade their land. Then, in the fourth and final section of the novel, it's actually written in an epistolary form, and this is this, and it's the letter which Sissy writes to her boyfriend, who has already decided to stay in exile in some other country. So in this section,
you can wind up.
Okay, am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are.
Okay. So in the final section, we can understand that some people think that their only duty is to send some amount of money to their family members and stay away from all the deeper commitments. So what I understand from this entire story is that Sissy, as the eye of a community, understands what actually colonialism has done to her people. And she's also a radical who stand in strong opposition to the African diasporas in England or in Europe. And thus we can say that this novel is a response to the self-exiled people who try to be known as Binto. And it also focuses on the effects of Europe on the young African. It sponsors the best education and lifestyle, and also how the white Europeans and black Africans are misguided about the realities of race and racism in their everyday life. Thank you.
So what is your suggestion for us?
I think the African people must rethink before migrating to the European nations. Or even though they migrate, they must have a love towards their nation. And it's given in this novel that a doctor saying that his profession is a complete waste in his country. So he thinks that his profession is a waste in his country. And thus he says he continued to educate the Europeans over there to recognize his country's worth. But I'm saying this with an example, but he could have gone to his own country and worked there to build a better nation. So I think this is a solution for this problem.
Yeah. Oh, good. And your name?
Malavika.
Okay. Thank you. Malavika, right?
Yes, sir. Malavika, yes.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Next, Joe Britt Rodrigo.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, sir. I'm Ajita Badar from Ajita College of Arts and Science, And the topic of my paper, the glass ceiling effect in Shimam and her Gauri Adichie, we should all be feminist. And the objective of the paper is of glass barriers. The beautifully showcased by Shimam and her Gauri Adichie essay, we should all be feminist. And she says that gender is always a matter of weight. And this is what the main of, and she argues, and this essay is full of her arguments about gender. The body. So what is the glass ceiling? The glass ceiling is a key term for the social barrier that from being to top positions, from family to the or from shops. So the ceiling is difficulty faced by women in trying to move to high male-dominated society. So, especially the problem that the instrument to fight. So she wants to say that you want to fight. And all the men looking this to matters which is not so. So, women writers represent freedom. Adichie, Shimam and her Gauri Adichie exposes lasting effect from the woman she met in life. She says that the word feminist, the word itself, a great threat to gender. So, she understood this concept because the reason is she said the problem or glass ceiling at a young age. So when she was at 14 years old, she played with her friend, Oklum. So the boy, in an argument, he says that you know, feminist. So did she then know the meaning of the word? From she understood that, like if someone saying to you that you know you are a terrorist. So she understood the but she understood the way that her friend told that it was something negative. And Adichie not only showcased the glass ceiling effect of men, but also brings into limelight the solution to break the glass ceiling. Usually, the society thinks that the breaking of glass is looked as the work assigned to. But here, Adichie educates the society that both men and women are intended to the glass ceiling because it is an obstacle both gender to the sky. And also says that women are considered invisible in many situations, and she narrates many incidents in this. And also she finds this is a strong layer of a glass ceiling which tries to exile the women completely of the world, and this generates the society to be broken. So when she writes this injustice in her talk, and she was quoted aside from her society. And this is what the reason is. And one of the friends told Adichie that if her mother advised her not to talk of Adichie because she will not get married. If she talks with Adichie, the woman wouldn't be married because the woman, if a woman speaks for her, society. And the society threatens women with the name marriage. So speaks for her right, she will not. But that women, that being a spinster seems to be a national shame. That is what a thought that is fixed on every woman. So that is what Adichie says, that instead of the exaggeration of the society should be broken. And she tries to express this injustice in her talk. And also, she says that there are many layers of glass ceiling which should be broken. What she gives a solution to break the glass ceiling, that lies not only in the life of women, but also in the life of men too. So even though she blames men for ruling the world, she also stages the problems of Thank you. So, as a creative writer, she told society, because the society is teaching the girl to close your legs, to my teeth, of men, and she also...
Your name? Come again.
My name is Arjobrit Rodrigo.
Okay. And what are your findings actually?
So what my finding is, so we should raise both boys and girls differently. That is what also the best of Adichie do. So because now early stage of our life itself, we are just bringing boys and teaching girls a different life schedule. That a boy means you should be very rude, you should not express your emotions, you should be hard, and to mask your true self, because you have to be, and then only you will be accepted by the society. So this is what we should raise both boys and girls differently. Even though a feminist, our Adichie pinpoints the problems of the gender generally, not only she speaks for women. So what is the answer she finds at last is, the best feminist is not only is for women. The best feminist she understood and she notices is her brother Kim, because he is a kind and good looking, a masculine young man, and he understood. And I told you in the beginning of the presentation itself, her friend told that you are a feminist, it seems to be a terrorist. So now only she got an answer and referred the dictionary. And I would like to read in front of you that a feminist is a person who believes in the but her brother Keen. So whoever speaks for the rights of women, they all feminist without the bias of gender. So men should join hands with women to break the fake ceilings of the glass which stops everyone to fly high. So men should see women differently, and also the different differences one can find in women gender among gender is only the biological difference. And apart from that, there is no more differences among men and women. So men should come out of the cage of ego and see the world in a new way. So yes, should understand the concept that
it is. Ma'am, thank you, and we'll move on to the next participant. Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah, you did a good job. Thank you. We'll move on to the next participant.
Thank you so much.
And what are your suggestions? In what?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you, sir.
Ma'am, come again. Hello. Am I audible? The last participant.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can you give me one important suggestion from your paper? One recommendation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Hello. May I know what you are trying to?
No. For the society, for us, can you give me one recommendation from your, based on your paper?
From the based of my paper, okay, sir. So we should, the only one thing I wish to recommend is to raise the children differently. Because from the early childhood itself, we are you can see the difference. To girls, we are giving the toys of the household utensils, but to boys, we are giving the toys of machines and everything. So these differences should be changed from the childhood itself. That is, parents should have the awareness to raise the children differently. Then we have no problem in future.
Yes, ma'am. Good. And this is what Simon Dibabu says in the second sex, when she talks about the doll.
Yes, sir.
Which is given to a girl child.
Yes, sir. Yes, operation. Sir.
Good.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Next to Jebisha. Jebisha. Okay, Mandeep Kaur. Okay, next, Professor J. Maria Jayamini. Okay, Professor Nambirajan.
Yes, ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, good evening, everyone. And once again, Sivaram sir, good evening. This is Nambirajan. Hope you remember me.
Yeah, good evening.
See,
how are you?
Good to see you. Good to, fine, sir. How about you, sir?
Good.
Yes, good to see you, sir.
Okay. Yeah, carry on.
Okay. My research paper topic is Insensibility and Curbing Identity in Mahesh Dattani's Tara. And my paper tends to analyze and project an aspect which is as old as Hills. It's nothing but the biased nature of a society made male dominant society, as which is and which we could see from our Puranas, even from Ramayana, this very same thing is being continued. But the most important thing of discrimination which I would like to bring to the limelight is not about the discriminations which the society imposes on the women, but the family. Okay, this domestic discrimination is the biggest threat today everyone is facing, and this is what our protagonist Tara itself is facing in my paper. Tara is a conjoint twin with her brother Chandan. Okay, CMS twins technically. They had three legs with them, but when the doctor advises them that two out of three legs is suitable for Tara, but her own mother and her father, they decided to amputate the leg from Tara and decided to give it to the boy child Chandan. But unfortunately, this unusual nature didn't suit for him, and this leg lost just for 2 days. And due to their biased nature, this grave mistake put the life of Tara in a complete jeopardy for the rest of her life. And there are many examples, like Tara's father, he wants his son to accompany him whenever he goes to his office, but he doesn't need the company of his daughter. Okay, and again, Tara's grandfather, he uses his political influence to help only his grandson. He gives his wealth, he gives his everything to one and only to his grandson, not to his granddaughter. Okay, so when it comes to these domestic discriminations, the major thing which we have to give attention to is many people accept this as the way we live. This is way of life. What this is how we live. There's nothing wrong in that kind of notion. But when we give a conscious attention to such things, okay, definitely we'll come to know that truly we are insensible towards women in many aspects of life. This is what my findings are all about in these papers. Anything? Am I audible? Sir?
Yes, sir, you're audible. And what is your suggestion based on your paper?
So based on my paper, we used to discuss these things. This is because this is the age of feminism, right? Where everyone gives attention to such things, but most of the discriminations women face not outside their home, but within their home. And the thing which we didn't give attention to, again I'm telling you, is we are agreeing to what's happening to them. We agree that it's this is the way, that we couldn't change the way, but unfortunately the way which is which leads the which victimizes the womanhood for the rest of their life. And as an academician, as an individual, a part of the society, we should give a constant and a conscious attention to such discriminations to help our children in the upcoming days, in the future, sir.
Okay, good observation. And how do you find the responsibilities like childbirth, bringing up a child? What is your take on that while connecting with feminism?
Sir, basically, I'm not a feminist. I consider myself a humanist. Bringing, yes, sir.
Yeah, good. Carry on, carry on.
Raising up a girl child in this society, in this scenario, present scenario is it's confusing actually, because just like in another work in our Dattan is dance like a man. That's a very interesting line we can quote. It says, no offense, I'm saying this in advance. Women in men's world is considered progress, but men in women's world is called pathetic. Whenever we raise such questions, okay, it brings us to a juncture which doesn't give a clear idea for us. But I believe it's a great responsibility, and give fullest attention and take things unbiased and lead them in a good way, sir. Is my answer acceptable?
Yeah. I asked the question just to test your say depth of social understandings. I'm so happy. Very good.
Are you satisfied with my answer, sir?
No, I'm really happy with your thought process. Good.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Next participant.
Professor Nazima. Professor Nazima. Okay, yes, hello. Nandini. Okay, Nazima. Okay. You can present. Okay.
Actually, I was in section one. Hello.
You are audible.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. So I want to turn my camera on. Hello.
Yeah, you can start.
Yeah, I'm Nasima, assistant professor of English department from PMSD, Arts and Science College, University of Calicut. Today I'm going to present, my topic is backlash on masculinity, a path of self-discovery in Kamala Das, my story. Kamala Das is one of the renowned writer in Indian English literature, is well aware of her role as a women writer. Her bold expression establishes her subjective identity in patriarchal setup. Her confessional writing enables the reader to probe into the deep layers of her inner self and bring out her multiple selves. She tries to establish her identity as a woman and as a writer through her autobiography, My Story. She has appeared as a debate subject after publishing this famous autobiography in 1989. It is just due to her confessional mode and her boldness as a writer that her place among the autobiographers is unique. She contributed to the discussion of much of the problems that represent the whole of women community. They have opposed the conventions like male dominance and have exposed. While most of the autobiographies remains silent when expressing their intense feeling of love, hate and fear, and details of their sexual encounter and painful psychological experiences, Kamala Das has been bold enough to tell everything in her private life. Though she is criticized for being bold in her expression, she becomes successful in asserting herself and establishing her identity. Though her writings, she becomes a voice for the voiceless women. Her writings content varies from religion to politics and secret of Nayo human life. She was not forced to stay on this topic and never avoid announcing a change of mind. As a lover of literature, especially who love feminist literature, it is very hard to escape from the influence of Kamala Das' writings. She blatantly wrote taboo topics at the time, such as female sexual desire, sex, and adult age patriarchal society. This book was written with original frankness and became a best seller. She wrote about the text evoked multiple reactions of administration criticism among the readers and critics. The reason could be her bold behavior to confess in autobiography.
Ma'am, your findings.
Yeah. Through this autobiography in my story, we know even in the 21st century, the some of the women are domestically, they have many problems. The male or patriarchal society, they do not accept the feelings or emotions of the women. They didn't give a space for them. Hello?
Yeah. And what is your recommendation? Based on your paper, what is your recommendation?
Yeah, I would like to recommend that if in a family, when we take the family, where we want to give equal respect and open space for both male and female, only through this mutual understanding, we can continue our life in a fruitful or peaceful way.
So my question to you is this, just to I'm just excited to get the answer, that is all. Don't you think in our society women are respected, in our families women are respected a lot, number one. Number two, women do have the say in every important decision that happens or that is being taken in a family. Okay. I repeat the question. Number one, women are respected. Number two, women also are decision makers. Just think about what is happening around in your family and your friend's family, all right, probably in the society. And based on your understanding on that, can you come up with an answer?
Yeah, actually, I want to try that. In our society, both male and female have gave respect, but in some of the middle class family, there have some in cases women didn't get a space, but some of the many educated or some other families, they gave importance to women. But some of the middle class families, the women have no voice. Even in the here in the my story, Kamala Das expresses their first marriage or a sexual relationship with her husband. When we take some of the middle class or some is lower class family, the women also having some problems like this. So I want to try.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Next participant.
Next, yes, Nandini.
Ma'am, previous participant's name.
Naseema.
Nazima. Okay. Yes. Thank you. Nandini, you can start.
Okay, next, next, Dr. Pridham Singh. I think Nandini is not present here, sir. So next participant, Dr. Pridham Singh. Okay, next, or Rajini Bula Sopika.
Ma'am, am I audible, ma'am?
Audible.
Yes, your name?
Rajini Bula Sopika.
Okay, you can start.
Good afternoon, everyone.
I am R. Rajini Vila Shobhika, studying second MA in Sendamarai College of Arts and Science, Madurai. First of all, I thank the college for providing me this opportunity. Now, I present my paper, The Futility of Violence in Gugiwa Thiong'o's Weep Not Child. Violence does, in truth, recoil upon the violent, and the schemer falls into the pit which he digs for another, said by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Violence is never a solution to any problem. History has proved it several times. Even our nation got freedom through non-violence only. Violence leads to violence, and it triggers a never-ending cycle of horrors. Also, violence turns detrimental not only to the doer, but also to the whole community. This truth is reflected in the novel Weep Not Child by Gugiwa Thiong'o. Gugiwa Thiong'o, the unforgettable writer of Kenya, set a landmark in post-colonial literature by his expression of the harsh impact of colonialism upon the Africans. He is a versatile writer. Weep Not Child is his first novel. It is set in a Kikuyu village during the emergency period. Weep Not Child has a simple storyline. Gotho was a worker in Mr. Holland's plantation. He had two wives, Jerry and Nyokabi, and five sons, Boro, Kori, Kamau, Joroge, and Wangi. Wangi died in World War II. Gotho was working on the land he once owned, so he had bitter feelings against the wife. Joroge was sent to school. There he was assisted by his friend Vihaki, the daughter of Jacobo. Jacobo owned the land in which Gotho and his family were living. Once Jacobo compelled strikers to return to work, Gotho attacked Jacobo and it initiated a riot. So Gotho was expelled from his job and the land. 2.5 years passed. The whole community was in perplexity due to the Mau Mau rebellion. Jacobo was murdered and police doubted that Gotho was involved in it. So Gotho and Joroge were tortured inhumanly. Holland pitied Joroge and arranged for his release. Actually, Boro killed Jacobo to avenge his brother's death. Gotho passed away. Boro turned ferocious and killed Holland. Joroge had to give up his education and to work in a dress shop. He met Vihaki. Both admitted that they loved each other, but they could not unite as sense of duty to their families lay on them. Joroge tried to commit suicide, but Nyokabi stopped it and brought him home. In this novel, Gugiwa Thiong'o focused on the futility of violence and its devastating impacts even upon those not involved in it. Following are the instances in the novel that validate this view. Gotho's assault of Jacobo ended up in a riot. He lost his job and house. Gotho's violent act proved detrimental to himself and his family. Mau Mau revolutionaries could not achieve independence from the British, but their violent activities led to the loss of serenity and harmony in the village. Joroge and his friends were on a search retreat. Police murdered their leader. Enraged Boro murdered Jacobo. Boro's mindless action disempowered his family. Joroge's studies came to an abrupt end. Gotho and Joroge were brutally tortured by the police. Gotho died, so Boro killed Holland. It affected Joroge extremely. He had to forsake his education and he could not join hands with Vishaki. His life went completely out of course due to the harsh and violent deeds of Boro. Boro's actions ruined the happiness of the entire family. Boro undertook violence because of the violent experiences in the war. He could not tolerate the death of his brother in the war. His father's recollection of the loss of his ancestral land and now working there as a laborer upset him. He began to take revenge upon the British colonizers, but it paved way for a series of brutal acts. Though he saw that his revengeful deeds in turn yielded harm to his family, he could not give it up. He stopped fighting for the cause of regaining their land and he became obsessed with killing, but he couldn't get any sense of peace with it. The violent deeds of the characters proved futile and detrimental not only to themselves but also to their beloved ones. Gotho's violence ended up adverse to himself and his family. Violence of the Mau Mau revolutionaries created tension and rivalry in the village. Boro thought that he was trying to get justice to his family, but it completely ruined Joroge. His optimistic vision of a bright future for the educated young people was completely shattered. The subaltern expressed their anger through violence, which ended up futile and disastrous. Through these instances, Gugiwa Thiong'o revealed that violence is futile and it brings ruin to all. Thus, the futility of violence is brought out through ample examples in the novel Weep Not Child by Gugiwa Thiong'o. Thank you.
and you have to be able to have like a lot of other things.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah, what is your recommendation? Just one or two lines.
The subaltern should fight for their rights and should achieve freedom not through violence. They should resort to non violent methods.
Yeah, thank you. Next participant.
Sir, that's all, sir.
Okay. Right. So I'm really happy with the way people came up with different ideas. Almost all papers had unique findings. I'm so happy with the way the whole session went about. Wish you all the very best. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. The evidence of your commitment is the success of this conference. We thank you from the bottom of our heart. On behalf of the organizing committee and JP College of Arts and Science, I would like to thank all the participants and our special thanks to our speaker, that is Dr. K. Shiva, sir. Thank you, sir, for taking the session, sir.
Yes, ma'am. My pleasure. Thanks a lot.